Dear students, in this module titled as Need of Population Projections, we will be covering the various aspects like the uses and the various needs for which the population projections are meant for, and also the way we need to adopt the techniques through which the projections can be made, and major differences that exist between population projections and population forecasts, and also how to see the various assumptions that are existing, the components that comes in this which can be taken into consideration while projecting the population, and at the same time what are the ways we have to consider when we frame and project the population for different years of future. In this regard, the projections are very important not only for assessing the number of people who are going to be there in future periods of time, but also it will have a strong base for formulating various programs and schemes and laying down the policies framework, and at the same time for a development of the society, how best the resources have to be allocated and also how these programs have to be executed. In this context, the present module focuses on what are the needs for projecting the population. Population projections can be used as a tool to provide information on possible sources of future populations, and namely to support decision making processes in diverse socio-economic areas such as higher educational institution network planning, both in private and public sectors. The dimension and the age and sex composition of future populations are influenced by the three components of population growth, namely fertility, mortality and migration. So, an accurate estimation of those future trends is crucial to evaluate how many inhabitants we will face in the future and simultaneously to prepare ourselves for their future needs. Knowledge of present and future population size and composition by age and sex is essential for planning, policy making and to conduct the diverse socio-economic analysis. A population projection estimates the needs and the amount of resources that have to be distributed to satisfy such needs. For example, a population projection provides the number of children 0 to 4 years old that they are the in the country, which is essential data to plan an immunization campaigns. It also supplies the size and evaluation of the population at school age so as to plan the future demand of classrooms and teachers. The present and future population is also an essential input to analyze demand for housing and utilities. Moreover, a population projection also provides the denominators for several indicators such as diverse economic activity rates. In this context, we need to know about the major difference that exists between population projections and population forecasts. Forecast has an element of prediction into the near future by using current data and sophisticated instruments. Population projections, on the other hand, are usually carried out based on a number of alternative assumptions based on the trends of growth and other linked factors like future policy of the government, attitude of people, etc. A forecast is based upon assumptions reflecting the conditions the business expects to exist and the course of action reasonably expected to be followed. A forecast can utilize a specific monetary amount or a reasonable range based on the various assumptions in place. In this context, we need to know that population projections take advantage of the two strong points of demography: the accurate recording of demographic processes over a period of years and the momentum that links demographic processes for one time period with those for another, because the future is intimately tied to the past projections based on past trends and relationships raise our understanding of the dynamics of population growth and often provide forecasts of future population change that are sufficiently accurate to support good decision making. The diverse and increasingly influential roles played by population projections make them an important part of modern demographic analysis. Important components which have to be considered in the forecasting is that there are three significant factors that influence the population projections, namely fertility, mortality, and migration. Mortality forecasting has received a great deal of attention. Mortality projections are based on projecting future life expectancy at birth for males and females, defined as the average lifespan of a child born today if current age-specific mortality levels were held fixed in the future. Where mortality is relatively high and the resulting life expectancy at birth relatively low, changes in mortality plays an important role in future population size. Where mortality is already low and life expectancy has risen, mortality has much less effect. Throughout developing countries, infant mortality has declined substantially over the last several decades. The general assumption underlying population projections for all countries is a continued decline in death rates and an increase in life expectancy. Each time, demographers had underestimated gains in life expectancy. While these underestimates of life expectancy had little effect on overall population totals, they understated the future size of elderly populations and accordingly the looming challenges of population aging for retirement and social security programs. In the case of fertility, it is generally agreed that fertility and births are non-stationary series, Hermes in 1992. In the long run, the level of fertility has the greatest effect on population growth because of its multiplier effects. Additional children born today will have additional children in the future. Fertility projections are made by projecting the course of the total fertility rate over time and translating this total fertility rate into age-specific fertility rates. Forecasting fertility rates rather than births has several advantages, including in deriving births, making use of the fact that the number of women is known with near certainty for the first 15 years. Miller 1986 forecasts total fertility and the mean age of childbearing by a transfer function model linking past quantum to current tempo. Demographers generally assume that fertility will eventually stabilize at a specific level in every country, usually at replacement level. In most industrialized countries, not including the United States, average fertility is now below the 2 child per woman replacement level, and experts have been engaged in a spirited debate about whether fertility will continue to fall, level off, or rise again to stabilize at replacement level. Environmental change and fertility. Environmental change has had a historically important effect on various demographic rates, including fertility. For example, Galloway 1986 found that warmer than average periods in middle latitudes were associated with the above average population levels and vice versa. The suggested mechanism was climatic influence on agricultural output and food supply per capita. Links between environmental change, agriculture, and fertility can be mediated by a number of factors. men may leave the community to seek work in adjoining agricultural regions or in cities. Lee 1990, Hill 1989. Marriages may be delayed because couples lack financial assets, expectations, and the incremental nature of many crises also play a role. For example, Dyson 1991 found an anticipatory demographic response in South Asia, where famines were preceded by extended periods of worsening adversity during which fertility declined. Caldwell et al. 1986 found that stress resulting from the 1980-83 South Indian drought was associated with a preference for fewer but more educated children. Now let us focus on migration. Future international migration is more difficult to project than fertility or mortality. Migration can be volatile since short-term changes in economic, social, or political factors often play an important role in international migration, has been largely neglected in demographic modeling or forecasting. The reasons for migration is taken into account by decomposition, levels and age sex patterns or forecasts for the different types of migrants such as labor, dependents and asylum seekers. Nonetheless, migration can have a significant effect on population change in specific countries and region. Migration can have a significant effect, however, on population change in specific countries and regions. International migration accounted for nearly half of the population growth rate in more developed countries in the 1990s. For example, flows of refugees following political or civil unrest have also altered the demographic landscape in some less developed countries. The use of population projections in policy formulations, the report titled "The Use of Demographic Trends and Long-Term Population Projections in Public Policy Planning at European Union, National, Regional and Local Level" depicts the significant usage of the population projections with the help of the certain case studies. Population projections in pension policy and public finance planning. The first case study is the use of demographic projections in pension policy and public finance planning in two countries, one with a relatively stable historical development, example Finland, and one experiencing a rapid transition, example Lithuania. The example case shows clearly that demographic variants have been widely used in policy planning but without effects to decisions. Stochastic population simulations have recently been presented and discussed in Finland and to a lesser effect also in Lithuania, but it is too early to assess their usefulness in practice except by noting that they are a more demanding instruments than conventional population projections. Population projections in immigration policy. The second case study focuses on the use of demographic projections in the design and implementation of immigration policies at the national level. The motivation is twofold. Firstly, the huge geographical differences in living standards may cause new large migration flows. Secondly, the expected decline of working age population and the acceleration of population aging may lead to increasing numbers of labor migrants. The countries chosen for this case study are Germany, Spain, and Netherlands. They all have different experiences of and future needs for migration. For instance, in Germany, there seems to be no link between demographics and immigration policies. The same appears to be hold for Spain as well, although that may be changing now. In the case of Netherlands, in contrast, information on past and future demographic developments, especially concerning population of non-Western origin, have been frequently and increasingly used for making migration policy recommendations. There are also substantial differences in the availability of data concerning migration and its impacts on demographics. The German report mentions a specific case of missing research, the impact of migration on the demographic structure of the population at the regional level is not well researched. Population projections in urban and regional policy is a very important note that we should keep in mind, especially given the changes in the urban composition and also the focus more on regional policy formulations. Population projections forms a larger scientific base for working out appropriate programs and schemes, and as part of that, the policy which reflects on how to keep a balance of various regions' growth and also to have a uniformity in allocation of resources. These are all very important, for which the population projections, especially reference to urban and regions, are very important. In this context, the population projections are very vital for the policy. The huge variation in the age structure in different districts and the strong selectivity of migration with respect to age highlights the need to both regional and local population forecasts. The third case study reports on the use of population projections in the Helsinki region in Finland and in the design of spatial and housing policies in the Netherlands. Over or underestimating future population change may lead to wrong decisions with respect to service networks, land use plans, or infrastructure. Omitting the information of population projections can also cause non-optimal decisions of service network, and the case of the Helsinki region found evidence of that. The report also notes that well of six functioning administrative population registers in Nordic and several Central European countries make it possible to produce a reliable and sufficiently detailed population statistics. However, there are major problems in the quality and availability of population statistics, especially in the new European Union countries, especially the incomplete registration of out-migration. What are the assumptions while projecting the population? The accuracy of population projections depends considerably on the accuracy of the underlying assumptions. Demographers attempt to make the best assumptions possible based on the existing evidences and revise them as new information becomes available through various sources such as national censuses, vital registrations, immigration statistics, and demographic surveys. Therefore, it is critical that policymakers and planners understand the assumptions behind different projection series. It is also important that users reject the common misunderstandings about population projections and instead understand that countries do not immediately stop growing when fertility reaches replacement level. Fertility does not decline automatically as assumed in projections without investments in areas such as family planning, health, and education of women and girls. Population levels do not necessarily stabilize in the final year for which a population is projected. Now, let us discuss about the limitations of population projections. Population projections are made by institutions and demographers, but many times they are often incorrect. The following are the limitations of population projections. Number one, wrong assumptions. Demographers do not use a uniform method for making population projections. The projections are bound to be incorrect because the mathematical and growth component methods are based on different assumptions. As pointed out by J.S. Davies, I quote, "It's not calculation of projection that is wrong, but assumptions make a projection wrong." Number two, estimation of mobility of labor difficult. It's not possible to estimate correctly birth rate, death rate, and migration rate due to the mobility of labor, especially in a developing economy. With the development and structural transformation, there is a large-scale mobility of labor within and outside the country, which cannot be projected correctly even for a short period. Number three, difficult to estimate age-sex structure. Population projections may turn out to be wrong during the demographic transition stage because it is difficult to estimate correctly the age-sex structure of the population. Number four, conditions likely to change. According to Goman, I quote, "Demographic projections are like weather forecasting. Like weather, they are based on conditions, and if conditions change during the calculation of projections, they may be incorrect." Number five, based on hypothesis. As population projections are based on hypothesis, they are many a times turned out to be untrue. W.G. Barclay opines, quote, "Any calculations of future populations are, by their nature, hypothetical." Number six, artificial and undependable. J.J. Spengler quotes Schuller that, quotation, "Economists have become accustomed to committing a considerable variety of artificialities in their collection, treatment, and interpretation of data. They artificially mechanize, simplify, generalize, systematize, fixate, factorize, close, semi-close, and isolate. Unavoidably, therefore, predictions about economic reality which are produced with the aid of those techniques are quite undependable," unquote. Despite these limitations, demographers and institutes continue to make population projections. In conclusion, we have to emphasize that population projections are important only when they are for a short period. The projection for long period are possible only in a static economy. When the economy is dynamic and social, political, and external factors affect it, the projections are rarely true. Praveen Visaria has shown that all projections in 1961 regarding India and Pakistan proved to be false. This does not mean that projections should not be made or used. While making projections regarding birth and death rates, it should be kept in mind that the projections for birth rate are only successful if the information like total number of females having fertility, marriage remarriage rate, effect of family planning on citizens and its acceptance, etc., is available. Similarly, for making projections of death rate, the number of populations per doctor, daily calorie intake, disease resistance power, per capita income, development of medical facilities and economic development, etc., are the factors to be taken into account. If definite information is available regarding these and the projections are made consciously on the basis of such information for a short period, the projections are useful for demographic analysis. Thus, we can conclude by saying that population projections carrying out on a scientific lines for a short period is more realistic and highly useful for the society.